Good afternoon, everybody. I hope you have a good lunch.
Yes.
The challenge after the lunch is staying awake for the presentation. But I suppose that challenge is you too. I also have to keep myself awake. You've heard several people talk about internet governance, and you've heard several people deal with this question of the multi-stakeholder model, or a set of multi-stakeholder models. And the organizers of this event have asked me to speak on four really big topics. Actually, they combined two of them. One of the topics is digital divide slash digital dividend. So that's together perhaps, but still a huge area of national internet policy. The second topic is internet governance. Second or third topic, depending on how you want to count. And the final topic is network neutrality. On each of these topics, if you gave me 1 hour, I could go on and on and tell you everything I know about it. But I think what we have to do at this particular event is connect what you've learned so far, which is about the multi-stakeholder model, and connect that to these areas of internet policy, digital divide, intermediary liability, and network neutrality, and ask the most important question, which is, does the multi-stakeholder model hold the key? Can the multi-stakeholder model produce useful policy in these three areas? So in order to do that, I have to first go and deal with the whole question of what is multi-stakeholderism, and perhaps look at ICANN a little bit before I come back. And when I come back to these topics, I hope all of us can try and do this problem solving together. Ask a very frank question. Now that we have understood multi-stakeholder model in multiple ways, you've heard people that are part of the ICANN tradition, people who have attended thousands, well, not thousands, but tens of ICANN meetings, present to you what they understand as ICANN and the multi-stakeholder model, and I'm here for my first ICANN meeting. So clearly I don't know anything useful, but hopefully I will be able to provoke you with some of my thoughts. So the first thing is, many people have told you about internet governance. That's a big lie, because nobody governs the internet. That's impossible. Internet governance always should be dealt with by asking these questions. Who is doing the governing? Who is being governed? And internet is not the correct answer to the second question that I posed. Who owns the property and who pays the rent? Yeah, these are the most important questions. And in order to answer these questions, you don't need to know any of the ICANN acronyms. Actually, it's better that you don't know the ICANN acronyms, because then it's more easier to answer these questions. The more you get lost in the world of ICANN acronyms, the less easier you can answer very straightforward questions such as these. So the second thing, I think Farmender spoke about this a wee bit, which is, if somebody comes to you and says, I'm all about human rights, then that might not be as straightforward as it looks. The mask of human rights advocacy might be used to cover a straightforward economic agenda. Yeah, so always when somebody comes to you at an ICANN meeting or at an IGF meeting and says, I'm all about human rights, then the most important thing you should do is go to their LinkedIn page and see who has employed them in the past, because sometimes their position on human rights may be informed by the people that pay them salary. So that is the next thing to say. And then a big feature for those of you who come to ICANN meetings that is publicly announced on mailing lists and various other fora is you get to attend so many parties. And for me, that's very surprising. because I've gone for some of these parties at the IGF. And the most interesting question for me is who is not at the party. So usually civil society is all over the party, because civil society are people that come from a sector that doesn't pay very well. We can't eat fancy food like caviar and drink champagne. So the party is a great opportunity for us to participate in such wonders of modern life. But the more important question is, where are the people who were at the meeting but not at the party, and what are they doing right now when I'm at the party? That's the most important question that you should ask. So that is a research question. You can do it at this ICANN itself. You can join me and you can go to parties and tell me who is missing at these parties, and we'll try and think of what these people are up to. So Vinay has already dealt with this, which is international fora for internet governance, rulemaking, both soft law, discussion fora, where people just learn and don't produce norms and so on. The next thing you have to do is you have to be very careful when consuming propaganda. So whenever anybody presents you with an infographic like this, then it is not straightforward representation of the truth. It isn't a straightforward scientific truth, like somebody is teaching you physics or somebody is teaching you mathematics. It is propaganda. It is meant to influence your thinking in a particular way. So if you looked at this image, which is produced by ICANN, which is obviously like any nation state produces propaganda to protect its point of view, its existence, then you think that IAB is a distinct entity, ICANN is just a small entity like everybody else, and so on and so forth. This is your understanding of the various entities that are part of the internet governance ecosystem. But if you follow my research methodology, which is you ignore all the acronyms and you focus on the money. If you focus on the money, what you realize is that ICANN there, and entity that didn't show up at all on the previous slide called VeriSign, that is the entity that gives the most money to ICANN. And you can see various other contributions, and then you can see that IAB, IETF and IRTF are not even legally distinct entities. They are part of a single entity called ISOC. And then you can ask all sorts of very important questions, which is, why does VeriSign make so much money from the TLDs? What was the historical accident that resulted in that? Should we continue that tradition using ICANN doctrine of presumptive renewal? Or should we end that tradition and put it up for auction again, just like we do with Celcom Spectrum? And suppose we auction it, and suppose VeriSign has no more control over these TLDs, will we still trust VeriSign as the only corporate entity that can edit the root zone? Yeah? So these are all immediate questions that emerge. Of course, in one sense, ICANN is a dissipating mechanism. So whenever you ask tough questions like this, it's like, oh no, no, you should join one of our stakeholder constituency groups, you should bring it up as part of that agenda. So ICANN is very, very sophisticated when it comes to preventing these kind of hard questions from being asked. So you can decide again, do you want to play an inside game? Do you want to work as per the rules that ICANN has laid out for you? Or do you want to prefer to play an outside game, which is you can create noise on the hashtag, or you can write to all the reporters in India and say that the reason why Indian companies don't go for ICANN meetings is not because they don't care about internet governance, it's because the big pie that is available, the pie of rent, that is completely monopolized by incumbents like VeriSign, and there is no opportunity for Indian companies to make money, so obviously they're not going to ICANN meetings, and that's why only Indian civil society goes for ICANN meetings. Because we want to have the receptions, the cafe, the champagne and the caviar. Okay, so very basic things. So the moment you start asking about money, then till we asked this question in February 2015, nobody knew how much money ICANN got every year and from who they got it. This was not known at all. They did not disclose it. They claim to be great adherents of openness, but they don't disclose it. We through our advocacy, ask ICANN to disclose it. No, I'm going to make a presentation. I'm not going to take any questions because you've been exposed to a lot of propaganda. I have to give you counter propaganda, and I don't have enough time. Okay? So if you have questions, you can ask me on Twitter, and I will answer all your questions publicly. Okay? So this is not the time for questions and answers. Thank you very much. So then they say, actually, we're better than nation states. Our commitment to proactive disclosure, but we have seen proactive disclosure in nation states, especially in India, our FOIA regime, or freedom of information regime, or our access to information regime, or what we call in India indigenously is RTI. We have compared it with ICANN's DIPI regime, and we have clearly identified that the Indian transparency regime, proactive transparency regime or reactive transparency regime, is much better than ICANN's transparency regime. So it is not true that only nation states can learn from ICANN. It is also true that ICANN can learn from nation states. So that is on transparency. Let's move on. So let's come back to this governance. So I must say, so some people might be thinking, oh, this man is such a skeptic, middle-aged, grey-haired fool. He doesn't think that the multi-stakeholder model holds any promise. No, that's not true. I'm going to come to where I think the multi-stakeholder model holds promise, and I'm going to explain to you why it's valuable, and then when we go through our case studies of intermediary liability, digital divide, and network neutrality, we will see exactly where the multi-stakeholder model kicks in and how exactly it provides value. So, who does the governing? That was the first question I asked. So governments do the governing, but Vinay Kesri has very clearly explained that it happens only within their jurisdiction. Corporations do governing through their market power, and they can usually transcend jurisdictions. They can make rules across jurisdictions. So if you're not in America and if you're not in Europe, thanks to how corporations would like to adhere to intellectual property rules, you won't be able to see many videos on YouTube because it's not the rights have not been cleared for your jurisdiction. So that's a way in which corporations exercise jurisdiction. The technical and academic community, they also have regulatory power. The best example of this is through encryption standards. If you use as a citizen or as a corporation or as any other stakeholder group, you use strong encryption standards, then it doesn't matter how powerful the state is, it doesn't matter how powerful the corporation is, unless they use supercomputers and specifically go after you, it's very difficult for them to break the technical power that you're exerting through, for example, the cryptographic standard. And civil society also has some power, and I'm trying to draw a comparison. So can these entities self-govern? So, to some degree, governments can. They can set up principle-based documents like the Netmundial Arkham document, and they can say, we hope to harmonize our standards. The large entities within private sector can do self-governance. They can come together, like the Global Network Initiative, and they can, for example, agree on transparency norms when it comes to their private censorship, and then, or when it comes to cooperation with law enforcement, so they can standardize, raise best practices when it comes to transparency. Can the technical and academic community self-regulate? No. Can civil society self-regulate? No, of course not. Civil society can do many things, but we can't regulate ourselves. What is the target of regulation? You can see my third column, which tells you who can be regulated using this power. So different stakeholders have the power to regulate other stakeholders. With civil society, it's once in a blue moon. Once in a blue moon, we can make a big noise about ACTA, SOPA, PIPA, and then something happens. But usually, we're not successful at regulating the behavior of others. We can make a lot of noise, but it doesn't really work beyond that. The technical community can produce a lot of de jure standards. That means They can use standard setting organizations to produce a standard, but they cannot guarantee that all de jure standards become de facto standards. So again, it is less frequent and it's not very clear to what degree their power that they introduce through standards like cryptography, to what degree it will become a market standard. And private sector and governments are of course the big bosses in the room. They have the most regulatory power. So, how do we think through this business of the multi-stakeholder market? The first thing you have to do is ask what the most rabid supporter of multi-stakeholder model will not support. So this is a thought experiment. Please go around the ICANN meeting asking this question. You have to go around asking people, do you support the dismantling of the World Intellectual Property Organization? And do you support the repealing of all international IP treaties? And do you think that we should rebuild all those treaties using the multi-stakeholder model? So till date, I have never met anybody that thinks this is a good idea. So clearly, even the most rabid supporter of the multi-stakeholder model believes that some things should be done the multilateral way, and that is the World Intellectual Property Organization, which is part of the UN, and they come up with international treaties on copyright law and on patent law. Those treaties are accepted by nation states, implemented in domestic law, and it's very real governance. You infringe copyright, you'll be arrested and put in jail. That's it's a nice, neat form of governance, and we should deal with that. The next thing which you won't find in the multi-stakeholder model, and again, the ICANN meeting is a good place to go around and keep asking this question, you have to find an individual whose rights were infringed. You have to find an individual whose rights were infringed, and then they should have gotten justice, remedy, or redress through the multi-stakeholder model. So again, there's nobody like this. I have asked at several IGFs, I've asked this question. I'm going to ask now at this ICANN also, if anybody can stand up and say, my rights were infringed, and I wanted justice, not a corporation whose trademark rights were infringed. I'm not interested in those people at all. I'm interested in the individuals whose rights were infringed. So again, clearly, multi-stakeholder model is not very good at giving justice to the individual system. So then you run into the other problems with the multi-stakeholder model, which is it's very easy to prevent the multi-stakeholder model from delivering anything by tampering with consent and consensus, and also with this concept of diversity. So usually civil society is asked to bear all the responsibility for diversity. We want linguistic minorities, we want people from least developed countries, we want people who are disabled, we want sexual minorities. So there are all sorts of reasons why you would want diversity, and civil society is asked to produce this diversity. We don't ask for similar diversity from the corporate sector. We don't say that Google has been coming for IGF meetings so often, and we want actually better for Google not to come, and we want some small businesses to come instead of the large businesses. These type of proposals are never asked, but an endless demand is made, usually of civil society, to produce diversity. And this process of producing diversity and this never-ending goal of more and more diversity results in the multi-stakeholder model not producing dramatically effective regulation in many areas. So that is the first thing. The second thing is consensus itself can be gained. So we have noticed as part of some internet governance processes, like just like the movie Promised Land, corporate actors, you should watch this movie, The Promised Land, very interesting movie, to see how corporations can create NGOs that will take their positions and so on. So that is another thing that you should watch out for. So, multi-stakeholderism can be understood in a variety of ways. You could say that multi-stakeholderism is really forbearance. that the people that are promoting the multi-stakeholder model, what they're really interested in is forbearance. They don't want any regulation. That's why they're pushing the model. Or you could say, this is a more charitable view, that the multi-stakeholder model is a complement to classic command and control state-centric regulation, and that is because we allow for self-regulation. That's actually the most promising area for the multi-stakeholder model. You could say that the multi-stakeholder model is just a form of regulatory capture. I think VeriSign's role in ICANN is a kind of demonstration of this type of capture. And you could also say that the multi-stakeholder model is a way of co-opting dissent. That every time somebody has a problem, then you add them to the ICANN gravy train, and then you buy them international tickets to fancy locations, and then they stop complaining about what they were originally complaining about. So I will skip this point that I want to make, but you're welcome to come and ask me this, especially engineers, how the multi-stakeholder model, at least at the ITF, could be fixed by shifting from a time division multiplexing paradigm to a frequency division multiplexing paradigm. It's very much the ICANN idea, but let me go to Gunther Tubner. I think I've spelled his name wrong. And the paper I want you to read is Substantive and Reflexive Elements in Law. Substantive and Reflexive Elements in Law. This is the key academic paper that I hope you will read. So Gunther Tubner says that there are many stages of law. The first stage was repressive law. The second stage was autonomous law. The third stage is responsive law. Responsive law has two subcomponents. There's a substantive law and a reflexive law. And Gunther is very aggressive. He thinks there is also one more stage, which is pure reflexive law. And that is perhaps the multi-stakeholder solution. So repressive law is when the state is very closely coupled with the law. So it's the time of the medieval kings. The king is the law. Then there is a change after the medieval period is over. You have the system of courts. The judiciary is separated from the executive, and you have certain legal principles established in constitutions. That is the phase of autonomous law. You move on to the next phase, which is responsive law. It's a mix of substantive law. Substantive law now not so much about principles, but about policy objectives. You can think of the Right to Education Act in India as an example of such a law. It's not so much about fairness as a general principle, but much more about a specific objective. And then reflexive elements in the law, feedback mechanisms, so that the regulator will know whether things are going well. And then the final stage is pure reflexivity. You decide that you no longer need legal principles, and you no longer need policy goals. Just through process fix, we will solve the problem. So that was all too complicated. So let me give you a simple example. Two siblings, brother and sister, want to share cake. During the time of repressive law, the mother is the monarch. She will cut the cake into two pieces and give either sibling one piece, and you have to be happy. There is no appeal. During the time of autonomous law, there is a document on the refrigerator saying all children will be treated equally. The father is given the job of the judge, and the mother is, of course, the executive of the house. And if you have problems with how the executive has cut the cake, you can go to the father and appeal, and then the father will do justice. So that's the second stage, autonomous law. We move on to the third stage, which is you have a broad principle that it's not fairness as a doctrine, but all children should get equal amounts of cake, very clearly stated what the policy goal is. And then there is a monitoring regime, that when the cake is cut, people will come and look at it, or all the children will self-report on how well they did on the sharing of the cake. So there's a feedback mechanism so that the legal regime will know how well it is doing. And then we come to the last solution, which is pure reflexivity. That means you want the fix in the process. You have the fix in the process when you say that one child will cut the cake and the other child will choose the first piece. You understand? So in the pure reflexive solution, you have a process fix. You don't need the constitution with the legal principle. You don't need a policy objective. You don't need the mechanism of the judiciary. So that is a good solution. solution to many of our problems. If the subsystems in our contemporary world can automatically self-regulate and correct and so on, that's a good thing. We don't want to over-regulate because the state's capacity for regulation is limited. So therefore, wherever such self-regulatory mechanisms can emerge, wherever a particular subsystem can solve their own problem, then we should accept it as a useful thing. And usually such self-regulatory mechanisms are developed in an open and participatory fashion because they're all stakeholders should be happy. And therefore, the multi-stakeholder model, in that sense, as a avatar of reflexive law, is a good thing, and we should support it. And the solution is not to have the state or international government regulate in great detail every aspect of our lives, because we don't have unlimited regulatory expertise or capacity. So that is the point I wanted to make. So there is some good in the multi-stakeholder model, and ICANN, despite of its flaws, is perhaps a good example of how to make it work correctly. And therefore, as people interested in internet governance, we must contribute to what ICANN is doing, and we must also simultaneously not demonize the component, which is, we should not say that it can all be solved in the multi-stakeholder model. There are very clear pieces of the governance puzzle that can only be solved if the government gets involved or if international government gets involved. So just some more slides quickly to take you through the problems with the multi-stakeholder model. This is Hetmundir. These are the countries that did not participate in the one Hetmundir process. This is my critique in the Hindu business line of the Hetmundir output document. I claim it is a big disaster. So ISOC claims that Hetmundir outcome is a great success story for the multi-stakeholder model. I claim exactly the opposite. So please, you can Google that and look at it. INR transition. This is diversity at the INR transition. Clearly not diverse enough. Again, diversity analysis at the CCWG, all on our website. So you can hold the very same metrics against ICANN and say that they weren't doing a good job. And of course, nobody likes to discuss jurisdiction. Apparently, it is going to be discussed today at 1:45. It must have just started the discussion. But we've been asking about this from the beginning. And this is an excellent blog entry by my colleague Pranesh Prakash. And he makes the argument that it's not really a proper transition. Perhaps it's the beginning of a transition, but it does not solve the most fundamental question, which was raised all the way back in 2003, at the beginning of the business process. So that's please read this blog entry by Pranesh on my website. So coming to network neutrality, question: do you really think we can bring Facebook into a room and bring internet consumers into a room and bring the government into a room and bring the technical and academic community into a room and through rough consensus and running core or whatever it is that you want to use as the mechanism to arrive at the norm? Do you really think this is possible? I thought a very interesting column was one that I read just last week. So apparently, the FCC, which is the American regulator, published privacy rules last week. And the FCC says that if you're a telco and you want to take your subscriber data and share it with other data controllers, then these are the rules you have to abide with. Yeah? So a particular lobbyist who is interested in protecting innovative firms in the US said, oh my god, this is a massive U-turn by the US government. Till today, you have been telling other governments across the world that you're committed to the multi-stakeholder model. So how come How come you have now, on these privacy rules, decided to move unilaterally? How come you have decided to create rules that the big firms don't find interesting? So that was one commentator and one op-ed that I saw. You can just search for multi-stakeholderism in Google and these op-eds will show up. And the second op-ed said, oh, if you really want to take the multi-stakeholder model seriously, then the FCC should also repeal the network neutrality rules. Because open internet should mean that the corporation should be allowed to innovate. So some of the champions of the multi-stakeholder model think that A, you should not have privacy rules, and B, you should not have network neutrality rules. So this is clearly a view that is held by some of them. So the question to all of you, which I should open up, is how exactly will this work? Do you really think that a corporation like Facebook, that in 2 months spent 10 times what they spend annually lobbying lawmakers on the Hill, they spent it just on newspaper advertising in India, do you really think this type of a mega corporation that even constructs your reality, their algorithms decide what type of mood you feel. They have started to manipulate your mood. They will nudge you to go and register for elections. They understand you much more than anybody else. Do you really think this firm can be trusted in a multi-stakeholder context to protect network neutrality or to protect privacy and so on? That's the question I want to ask. So that's the case study, well documented. There's an excellent Guardian article. So if you go to the Guardian and search for Save the Internet and perhaps even Nickel Power, you'll get the whole story from the beginning to the end, blow by blow description of what went on. And read that story and please tell me how exactly would it work in the multi-stakeholder model. So that's story number one. We move on. So those are the sub-issues: blocking, throttling, price discrimination, paid prioritization, and specialized services. I put this in particular because of the second issue, which is throttling. According to a research paper commissioned by Ofcom, it is impossible, even using the most sophisticated software, to determine if your ISP or telco is throttling. So how can we then, as a multi-stakeholder community, how can we ensure that the rules are followed? It's actually quite a complex. Should we actually make those kind of rules that cannot be monitored? Is the FCC being stupid? Or should we just leave this to the Competition Commission? Should there be other rules about vertical separation? Should we be dealing it with through competition levers? Or should we be telling engineers how to run their networks? All of this is unclear. So it's good, and different countries are using different approaches to solve this problem. And it's a question that all of us should discuss. Of course, it's not going to be discussed in ICANN meeting, but it's being discussed across the world within jurisdictions. The digital divide. So let's get another nice example of the digital divide and where rulemaking may be necessary and where ideology may not be sufficient. Ideology may not be sufficient. Many of us think that as long as we have some ideology, we can clearly understand the future. So here, the digital dividend, of course, has all sorts of complicated layers. The first is hardware, software, and content. Just accessibility of hardware, software, and content has a lot to do with intellectual property. So we have done a mapping of every single patent in a mobile phone. And according to our analysis, if all mobile phone manufacturers paid all the royalties that patent owners want, that patent owners demand, there will be no more sub-$50 phones, there will be no more sub-$100 phones. This is a sub-$100 phone. These phones won't exist in the Indian market. So again, I don't see anybody saying, oh, that's a problem, and those are just evil policy documents developed in a multilateral forum, let's get rid of it and start off on the multi-stakeholder model. Nobody's saying this kind of thing. So that is the hardware, software, content layer bit. Languages is a big problem. It's a market failure. I don't see mega corporations coming around and addressing the dying languages of India. We, for example, produced a font for Santali, but I don't see mega corporations doing this. Accessibility by the disabled, all very important issues. But let's take unlicensed spectrum. Unlicensed spectrum is a good way to deal with the digital divide. All sorts of creative access provision can happen. And people like us who come to meetings like this will say, unlicensed spectrum, that's a good thing, we want maximum people to use it. And the best way to do that would be to say, let's assign that spectrum in a technologically neutral fashion. That means anybody using any technology can use the spectrum. But here comes the literature, which is there are two competing technologies, LTE-U, which is the version of the LTE standard for unlicensed spectrum, and Wi-Fi. They behave very differently. So Wi-Fi is like TCP. It listens before it talks. And once the utilization of the network resource is complete, it will vacate the network resource. LTE-U is like UDP, the protocol on which BitTorrent is based. It will speak even before listening. It will create interference. It will kill all the other connections on the network. Anybody who has young people using BitTorrent on their office network will tell you that this is true. And it will continue to squat on the spectrum even when it's not used. So therefore, like I said with my four stages of legal development, it's not sufficient just to say that we will have technologically neutral allocation of unlicensed spectrum. You have to say that if you want LTE-U, you can only use the variant of LTE-U that implements LBT, that implements listen before talk. We must regulate the cycle time so that after an LTE-U connection has been established, then the connection is dropped after the end of the cycle time and there is recontention for the spectrum again. Can you see? So again, not obvious that ordinary citizens will be able to come to a room, or even people from civil society. I didn't know anything about this. One of the people within the big telcos, he tapped me at a meeting and said, you don't know what is really going on. You're just pushing all that ideology with so naively, and you're going to help us. So let me tell you what is really going on. He had to tell me about these standards, and only then did I realize what was at stake in this battle. You understand? So it's not clear to me that we are equals at this table. It's not clear to me that once we go to these tables to negotiate, whether we will actually produce outcomes in the public interest or that protect individual or civil liberties. So that is the second example, and my final example, which is on intermediary liability. And here I want to be positive and say that this is one region, one place where perhaps there is a role for the multi-stakeholder model, or at least for these reflexive processes that don't launch a denial of service attack on the judiciary. The trouble with over-regulation, with regulating every aspect of the life of firms or individuals, is that you will have all sorts of issues with adjudication and appeals at various levels in the judiciary. So ideally we want to come up with a solution that allows for subsidiarity, where issues are solved within the subsystem. So intermediary liability, very briefly, is that intermediaries or internet platforms should be immune from any liability that might accrue from third-party content. Why? Because they had no actual knowledge of this content. They're just mere conduits. They're just places where third parties host this content. But this situation is changing, unfortunately, because intermediaries themselves are morphing tremendously. So our own work in this area on how these regimes should be best designed can be accessed from Manila principles. You can go and have a look at the work that several civil society organizations have done, including mine. But increasingly, these intermediaries are platforms. They're not letting third-party folk just control what is going on their platforms. Increasingly, they are publishing their own content as well. So it's not clear to what degree we should give them immunity. Increasingly, they're doing very serious things when it comes to countering violent extremism. So if you go on to Google and search for how to join the ISIS, they won't really take you to ISIS websites, which is the actual relevant content for that search query. They will take you to counter propaganda. They will take you only to those sites which prevent you from joining the ISIS. So they are now increasingly playing the role of editors and increasingly deciding what kind of content should be shown because they want to keep nation states happy. Nation states have a very legitimate complaint with these platforms when it comes to the rise of ISIS, and therefore this is the way they want to go. So intermediary liability regimes have to be reconfigured. Earlier it seemed very clear to us from civil society that we are on the same side as the intermediaries, that intermediaries want to protect free speech, intermediaries want to protect user privacy, and therefore we should support them, have common cause with them. Now it's not so clear anymore because increasingly they do a lot of private censorship, especially for intellectual property, and also increasingly for CVE, and also after Snowden, we have no idea what they really think of our right to privacy. So we have to reconfigure this. But a very neat version of intermediary liability is the notice and notice system. So most of us are only familiar with the notice and takedown system. So why does an intermediary get immunity from liability that emerges from third-party content? Because they take down content. And when do they take down content? When any affected party sends them a notice. Yeah, this is classic configuration. Even the American regime works exactly like this. But in Canada, they have tweaked it and they've made it better. So they say, you have a notice and notice system. So you, as affected party, send a takedown notice to the intermediary. The intermediary forwards that notice to the person who published that content on their platform. And then they ask that person, would you like to challenge this? If that person does not want to challenge it, they take it down. Yeah? So you can see now that you don't really have to overburden courts. You don't have to overburden any other form of dispute resolution. As long as you try and take care of the situation within the subsystem and within the parties that are affected by this. So this is an example of reflexivity. This is an example where the principle of subsidiarity is respected. This is an area where hopefully intermediaries working with each other can come up with norms. That's another way in which they can reduce the concerns of, say, women. Women are hounded and hunted on online platforms. So if these intermediaries do not want to be regulated because of concerns about women's safety or the widening gender gap on these platforms, then they can tighten their terms of service. And once they tighten their terms of service, the platform could become more hospitable for women, and therefore the regulatory threat of governments can be eliminated. So intermediary liability, as I thought about it more and more, seemed to be the clearest case for having greater amount of self-regulation based on the multi-stakeholder model. Though, as Vinay reminded me before he disappeared, it still depends on the broad legal framework. If there is no legal framework that gives such intermediaries immunity, then it won't work at all. So within a broad legal framework, of course, classic command and control, state regulation, an ecosystem of self-regulation and the multi-stakeholder model could emerge. So that was just my presentation. I didn't want to be interrupted because I'm hoping this will also go online and that I can share this presentation with others, my part of propaganda. So I'll take questions now, and I don't know if I have much time. If I don't, that's also fine. You can ask me questions on Twitter, which I shall gladly respond to. There is time for questions?
5 minutes.
5 minutes. Okay. Like everybody else. First time.
Sunil Abraham, I'm Dr. Govind here.
Yes, sir.
Very beautiful talk on the various critical issues in the internet governance area, and your analysis of the whole thing, which I was reading continuously through your website and all, tremendous efforts you made towards making these things visible and digging out really the issues happening in ICANN and some of the global platform. My question is regarding the LGEU.
Yes.
You talked about the previous slide.
Yes.
And the Wi-Fi.
Yes.
So how the corruption at one part and the regulation at the other part? How corruption?
Okay.
And the regulation. Because if your spectrum is, you know, option, then you say that non, you know, these spectrums of the public Wi-Fi, how to go about it if you distribute it just like that. So how to make a balance between the two? That is my question.
Okay. Do we have time for just one more question perhaps? Or
yes.
Okay.
Hello, Sunil. It is Anurag. I'm from India. I just want to ask that you were saying that denying information to people will not serve the purpose of the internet when you were talking about ISIS. Means government should not block whatever information citizens want to take from the internet.
No, I didn't say that. I was just saying that increasingly platforms are becoming publishers. Your platform, only if you act as mere conduit, that means people put material on your platform and you just serve the material to everybody. But if you're going to decide how to serve the search result, which is not going beyond Google rank and all that, then you're actually becoming an editor. You're becoming a publisher. You're not a platform. So I'm not saying that governments should or should do something. I'm just saying that platforms are no longer mere platforms. They are also becoming publishers.
You were saying that when people wish to know something about ISIS on,
yes,
Google, then that platform, is Google platform, send them to anywhere from which they get information about ISIS. But if they wish to join ISIS, then means they are supposed to not to join ISIS. Means,
yes,
that information they get.
Yes.
So means, do it serve the purpose of the internet? Or means, in my opinion, actually yesterday I too was discussing with Dr. Govind. I say that now it's the time that we have to decide that as being human means we are also responsible for the humanity. So is there the time to take consider the socio-technological aspects of internet governance? Yes.
Wow. Now, this is a deeply philosophical question and I'm not the best person to respond to it. I can answer very boring and simple questions. I don't think there's time for...
I have a question for you.
Okay. It's a very difficult question. I'm sorry, I'm not the right person to answer the question. I have very limited expertise.
Coming to how various sites are today regulating what we are seeing, what we are viewing,
yes,
what news we need to see, do you foresee multi-stakeholder decision-making model being able to bring neutrality to it? Or?
Okay, I'll answer both questions. So maybe in reverse order, when it comes to speech regulation by the sites, does the multi-stakeholder model hold promise? Clearly, where there is common cause, such as child pornography, the Internet Watch Foundation in the UK and the participation of multiple stakeholder groups is a clear example of how self-regulation is working to mitigate harm. Yeah? But at the same time, a lot of speech regulation on these platforms is based on intellectual property. It's based on enforcement of intellectual property. In India, we have all sorts of flexibilities to the IP regime. Our Delhi High Court recently ruled that copyright is not a divine right, that students in India can photocopy textbooks that they cannot afford. Yeah? So ideally, when an Indian student gets online, they should be able to get copies of textbooks, because that is a user right, an exception under Indian copyright law that is available to Indian students. But the global platforms, they are increasingly getting closer to the rights holders. Early days, Google used to support IP reform discussions and workshops. Now they don't support any more NGOs that work on IP reform, etc. So they turned around. So on that area, we're not going to get a multi-stakeholder solution. Dr. Govind's question, I wouldn't want to go into corruption. I think there is a systemic issue that we want to deal with. According to Ronald Coase, sir, if you don't have property rights, you will have tragedy of the commons. So if you don't give different telcos distinct property rights over the spectrum, then all corporations will try to speak on the spectrum and there will be a lot of interference. We won't be able to have any quality of service for mobile phones. But according to Michael Heather, excessive property rights will cause gridlock economy. So we cannot fetishize property rights, especially because increasingly today, the devices we use have cognitive radios. They are smart radios. They can hop frequencies. So ideally what the Indian government should be doing is allocating maximum spectrum in a shared spectrum paradigm, and using databases and self-regulation, people should be able to share the spectrum in an intelligent way. So looking at the governance question always from a property perspective is an interesting entry point, because that will help you solve some of these questions. Entrenched property interest results in corruption. If somebody has always controlled property historically, then increasingly they will be tempted to do corrupt things. But I don't think that is the important question. I think the basic question is, how do we deal with property rights? And do we need to reimagine property rights every time there is a change in technology? That's the question.
Thank you very much, Sunil. I'm sorry we don't have time. Please carry on with the questioning and the tea break. I'm sure all of us will agree that this is an extremely interesting presentation. Pretty provocative also.